Hey, what's up Blender users, I'm Jonathan, and in today's video we will take a look at how I created this 3D double exposure GIF with the use of Blender and Affinity Photo. Oh, and by the way, if you enjoy my content, consider subscribing because I upload a new video every Saturday. And with that said, let's get straight into the tutorial. To start off, we need some footage to create the basic camera move. Personally, I just set up my camera on a tripod and rotated my body to mimic a moving camera. Once I've done this, I used HitFilm to export 12 single frames, but you should also be able to do this in Blender. Just import your footage and render the frames you want to export with F11, and then go to Image, Save and save your image. Now we should have our 12 unedited frames in a single folder. The next thing is the tricky part, because we need to somehow track the not existing camera move. Let's go to Blender. I've tried using the motion tracking panel for the step, but the automatic camera solver just wasn't able to solve the camera move, so we will have to do it manually. Select everything with A and delete it, and now let's add in a camera. We can clear out the rotation with Alt R, press M and give it a rotation of 90 degrees on the X axis. Now let's move it back. Let's go to the camera properties and enable background images. Click Add Image and Movie Clip. Now we can press Open and locate our files. Once you're in the folder, you can press A to select all the images and open clip. Now if we press 0, we should be able to see ourselves. And if I hit play, you can see that the images are played correctly. Now, I know that for the final GIF, I only want it to be 12 frames long. So let's set the end frame to frame 12. And I want it to be 12 FPS. So let's select Custom right here and plug in 12 for our FPS count, just like this. And now we can see that we have this camera move. And this is exactly what I want. Now, let's track it. For this, I want to add in a cube, scale it down. And now we can somehow align the edges of the cube with the rotation of my face. But the camera should be moving in an arc around my face. So how do we do that? Well, we can just add in a curve, circle. And firstly, let's go in the circle properties and increase the resolution. That way our camera won't stutter when rotating around this curve. And now select the camera and add in a follow path constraint. We can then select the curve and zero out the location of the camera, just like this. And if we now adjust the offset, you can see that our camera is rotating along this circle. But we want the camera to stay focused to the middle. So let's add in an empty plane axis. Again, select the camera and add in a track to constraint. Select the empty. You can see that this messed up our rotation because we have to select different axes. What works in this case is negative Z on the two axes and up should be Y. Now if we adjust the offset, our camera is rotating around the cube. And if we go into the camera view, we can see that we have to scale up the circle. So let's do this. Select the circle, scale it up so the cube aligns with our face. And now we can adjust the offset and the cube is rotating around. Okay, great. There's one thing I want to add, and this is another empty. Move it upwards, and now select everything in our scene and parent it with Ctrl-P to this empty. Now you can control all this with the second empty. But there's one issue, and this is that the camera is starting to move. So select it, press Alt and P to clear out the parent right here. And now if we move this empty, you can see that it works like we intended it to do. Now we have to somehow line up the camera in every single frame. The first frame is of course front facing, so this is aligned correctly. Let's just go to the second frame, select the camera and adjust the offset. But let's also keyframe it on the first frame. Now let's go to the second frame and adjust it so the cube is facing in the correct direction. Again, keyframe it and let's go to the next frame. Again, adjust it and so on and so on. After a little while, I had this result. You can see the cube is following my face correctly. And for this, I had to move everything in the scene. So I also used this empty to control the location of the camera. But now this is aligned correctly. So we can start by adding in our scenery. For this, I'm gonna use the same landscape as I did for the last tutorial. So add in a new collection, let's call it mountain. And now if you have followed the last tutorial, go to File, Import, and Google Maps capture data and locate the file you want to import. Awesome, you can see that now the landscape has loaded in and it's all in this mountain collection. I also put the cube in its own reference collection, but we can disable this for now. Now let's right click on this collection and select select objects and we can scale them down. Let's move them to the correct place. I want the mountain to be inside of my head, so I will move it to the place where my camera is being tracked to. Just like this. We can scale it down a bit further to get an angle we like. And if we now play this animation, you can see that this mountain is almost perfectly tracked into the scene. You can of course adjust the location of the mountain to get a result that fits. For me, I want it to be a bit closer to the camera. Now, you can see that this obstructs our view, which is of course not what we want. So let's disable everything else than the mountain and delete all the unnecessary parts. Great, now we are left with this. You can see that we still have this fold right here. For this, we can just rotate our mountain, because still our camera is being rotated and not the mountain. So we can do stuff like this. Now let's enable back the camera and look at our result. Okay, the mountain isn't centered anymore, so let's select it again and move it to the center. And it is tracked to our face. There's one last thing I want to do, and this is to add clouds to our scene. For this, you can just follow CG Cookies tutorial. The result will be a node shader, which you can just import into your scene. To use it, just add in a cube and append the node group. Okay, I'm just gonna give it a new material right here, delete this node, and add in the cloud material node group. I'm gonna plug it into the volume input, and if we go into rendered mode, we should be able to see our cloud. Now, this all doesn't really look that great. How can we fix that? Well, first of all, I have already added in an HDRI, and if I disable transparent, you can see that it is just acting as our background. Now, the cloud can have its own collection, so let's do that. Now, let's disable the cloud and quickly go into cycles. Personally, I think the mountain looks much better in cycles, and you can also do the same trick I did in the last tutorial to add in ground fog. So, because the clouds are volumetric and render a lot faster in Eevee, I rendered the mountain in cycles and the clouds on a separate layer in Eevee. You can now just render out your mountain into an image sequence. Next, you can disable the mountain, enable the clouds, and go over to Eevee. To really make the clouds pop, we want to add in a separate light, which is going to be a sunlight, and we can just move it to a side, rotate it so it's facing the cloud. And if we go into rendered mode and disable the background, we can see that our cloud is working just fine, but it's not looking that great. So, under volumetrics, we can enable volumetric shadows. We can also turn down the tile size to 2 and up the samples. For the final render, I used a sample count of 256. We can also give the sun a higher strength, for example 15, so the cloud really starts to pop. And now we can also render out the clouds. You can see here in my folders that I have rendered out the mountain in cycles, as well as the clouds. And for this, I did two renders, one of clouds behind the mountain and one of the cloud in front of the mountain. This just allows us to more easily composite these in. Okay, let's open in the first frame of our GIF. First of all, we have to separate me from the background. For this, we can just use Affinity Selection Brush tool, refine it, and apply it to a mask of this layer. Next, let's add in a black and white adjustment layer and curves. This way we can make it a bit darker. Now let's add in a pixel background and just give it a gray color. For example, this right here. Now the next thing would be to add in our mountains. To do this, just drag and drop the first frame into our composition, and you can see that my background image is 4K and the mountain is rendered in full HD. This is okay, we just have to crop the image. Let's select the crop tool and crop it to full HD. Press enter, and now we have to scale me and the background. The mountain still has color, this is just because it's above the adjustment layers, so move it down. And we can now duplicate this mask and apply it also to the mountain. You can see that we still see the HDRI because I didn't think it all the way through, so I rendered this sequence without the transparent checkbox. But we can easily fix it, just select the mountain layer, and again with a selection brush, select the mountain, go to refine, and apply it as a mask. And now we have the mountain right here. Let's select the mask of the background and use a harsh black brush to mask the top of my head away. Now there are only a few things left to do. What I want to do is add in another curves adjustment layer, but only apply it to the mountain. And now we can make it much brighter, so it doesn't stand out that much. We can also select a mask and a very soft brush and fade out the bottom of this render so we don't have this harsh line anymore. Okay, great, this looks good. Now we just have to add in the clouds. For these, I will just drag and drop in the clouds which will be in front of the mountain. Now the clouds which will go behind the mountain. And also position them accordingly around the layer. Now you can see the clouds don't really stand out from the background that much. So let's add in another curves adjustment layer and only focus it on the clouds and make them much brighter. And we can now also duplicate this curves adjustment layer and apply it to the other cloud render. And now you can see they are much more noticeable. The one downside for this all is that you have to repeat all these steps for every single frame, but the result can turn out pretty cool. So this is how I created this GIF. If you enjoyed this tutorial, consider liking and subscribing. And we will see you in the next video, next Saturday.